Very good morning to all. On behalf of Nature Walk Charitable Trust, I welcome Mr. Isaac Kimkar in our sixth webinar session titled Butterflies of India. Isaac, to be very honest, needs no introduction, but as a part of the program, we'll introduce Isaac in brief. Isaac is a well-known naturalist, photographer, author, and a great teacher. He's also known as India's Butterfly Man and has authored many books, which includes the bestseller, The Book of Indian Butterflies, and Butterflies of India. He has worked a lot with BNHS as a deputy director, and now he is chairman and director of I Nature Watch Foundation. He has been felicitated with the many awards, which includes the Green Teacher Award by Sanctuary Asia, Kirloskar Vasundhara, Green Teacher Award, and many more. Magashi sangitla tyaprmane Isaac he naav jaja nisarga premi samstha ahet ta tyanna parichitacha ahe. आणि त्याला वेगळी ओळख करून खरं तर येण्याची गरज नाही. कुठल्याही मुलाला जर का बटरफ्लायचं एखादं पुस्तक द्यायचं असेल तर मला असं वाटतं आयझॅकचं पुस्तक इज द बेस्ट बुक अवेलेबल इन द मार्केट. आणि लहानपणापासून WWF एक पहिलं जुनं प्रोडक्ट होतं की जे मला माझ्या गुरूंनी गिफ्ट म्हणून दिलं होतं आणि ऑब्व्हियसली ते आयझॅक सरांनी दिलं होतं. ही इज जस्ट अ एन्सायक्लोपीडिया वेन इट कम्स टू बटरफ्लायज. And everybody is very eager to learn a lot of things on the occasion of Guru Purnima today from Isaac sir. So without wasting much of time, I request Mr. Isaac Kimkar to start with this session. Over to you, Isaac sir. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. Hello, good morning. Let me see whether I can be seen now. Video?
Yes, video. Sir. You are visible.
Okay, so good morning, friends. And I'm like so happy to be with you and love to share my passion, which I've been chasing since I joined BNHS. Of course, I've been interested in nature always when I grew up in Devnar, Govandi, where there was no television, no video games, and that's the time nature was only. And this is the time I has to be in the field. Like I has to sometimes stay home by some excuse, you know, not going to school, and then go for fish. You know, fishes now actually come from the creek to the freshwater to actually breed. And we used to with local agri and koli boys, I used to go catch crabs and frogs and fishes, and it was such an enjoyable childhood. You know, I sometimes miss all that. That, you know, that today's children actually, they're going there, you know, and that's where I actually caught up this nature's bug, you know, and that's the time also started catching snakes, which was a wrong thing to do, because I didn't know much about it. I could have made a fatal mistake. But butterflies, I have been catching butterflies like every child catches, and dragonflies, we always did that, our curiosity. But it was later actually when I joined BNHS. Actually, I was working with Tatas, and then I got offered to work with BNHS, and Tata was a good job. But what happened was, I told my mother that that I got a job in BNHS. So they said, how much salary they're giving? Are they giving better than Tata? I said, no, it's all not even half of what Tata is giving. So she got very angry and she was upset. She said, this is not correct. You ruin your life with going with this nature and all that. But my father said, ki, you know, basically let him be happy first. Because, you know, life, first you have to be happy and then money can come eventually. And he was right, actually. And he let me leave the Tata job and I joined BNHS. And that was where I grew up, actually. And I met people like Salim Ali, JC Daniel, and a lot of like-minded people, you know, good people I met. And we shared and I grew. And that's where I started, you know. And of course, I never inspired to write books. Or I saw Salim Ali working there. He was very, you know, people like Salim Ali are rare. Like, you know, now I think I stopped making people like this nowadays. So that was the time I grew up, and it was later on when I wrote, when Sanctuary Magazine started, actually. Sanctuary Magazine started, and Bittu Sehgal I met, and he actually wanted me to write books, write article for his Sanctuary Magazine. It was 1980. Maybe some of you are not born then. And then I wrote first article was actually on frogs, because I was that time frogs and snakes, you know, it was my passion. And later on, he said, write something different. So then I chose butterflies. you know, and then I had my own nursery that time, and butterflies were there on my lemon plant, kadi patta, and I wrote an art. And why common? I wrote on common Mormon. You know why common Mormon? Common Mormon is really common, but it has got such a complicated lifestyle. You know, it has got one male and three female forms, and then it has got this the camouflage of looking like a bird dropping, and then it turns green later on and merges with the leaves. And then it has got a special organ called osmeterium at the back of its head, and it shoots up when the wasp attack. So all that, and that butterfly emerging, and the magic of that butterfly emerging from the pupa is so magical that actually fascinated me, and that possibly was the starting. And possibly WWF also saw my article in Sanctuary magazine, and they approached me to Thomas Gaze had written a book on butterflies of Sahyadri, small booklet it was. It was actually rejected by BNHS, and it was lying for many months and years in WWF. They came, can you work on this? I said okay. When I started working on this, I realized he had written a chapter on how to catch butterflies, being a Britisher, how to kill butterflies, how to pin them, how to spread them. I said no, you in this book published by WWF, which I just mentioned that that you can't have a chapter on how to kill butterflies and how to pin butterflies. So that's the time I said we'll replace this with how to photograph butterflies, how to watch butterflies, and gardening for butterflies. That's the first time the gardening for butterflies concept actually I brought in this book, and that was the beginning of my butterfly chase, and it has never ending. And butterflies actually have shown me India. Otherwise I'd not gone to different corners of the world. With chasing from backyard, I reached to Ladakh, I reached to Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Ladakh, and Andaman Islands. I could have never gone there, but butterflies took me and showed me how beautiful our country is, how vivid, how diverse. I think few countries have so much of diversity like India. We are so rich. So I'd like to take you on this trail, actually, on my chase, how I chase butterflies across India and to share and discover India. And I'm telling you, one lifetime is not enough. It's so beautiful, so vivid. So let's start with that. And so can you see the screen now? Yeah. Hello? Can you see the screen? Hello, can you see the screen now? So basically,
yes, it's visible, sir.
Yeah, okay. Just give me so basically, I am now, after I retired from BNHS after a service of 38 years, of course, they wanted me to continue, but I said, I have got much to do, and now myself and Dr. Shubhalakshmi, we have. Founded this I Nature Watch Foundation, which is active in Navi Mumbai, and that was the beginning of what I learned from BNHS. I have to spread out and give the message more wider. What is the need of the hour? So I am now presently with BNHS I Nature Watch. I Nature Watch conducts several activities like we have now online courses on butterflies, on bugs, and gardening for butterflies. Maybe you can have a look at the Facebook. So we'll start with our. Presentation today. Basically, we are going to talk on butterflies, that is Lepidoptera. Lepidoptera, of course, what you're looking at as a moth, because moth were the first to arrive on the evolutionary scene. So you're looking at the face of the moon moth. Yeah. So,
Isaac?
Yes.
One moment. Screen sharing is off from your side.
Acha? Okay. It is showing here. It is.
Okay. I can see it. Okay.
Yeah. So, we are talking about moths, and then the butterflies arrived on the evolutionary scene. So moths were the first to arrive. Moths are the seniors of butterflies. Of course, for a biologist, moths and butterflies belong to the same Lepidoptera group. Lepidoptera, if you know that, Lepidoptera means scaly winged insect. If you happen to examine a butterfly wing under a microscope, you'll suddenly find the butterfly wings or a moth wing like a roof tiles. They have been arranged like a roof tile. And that is what they give the colors. And basically the colors of butterflies actually fascinate us, That's how we fall in love with butterflies, the kind of grace and the beauty of flight that fascinates us. And basically moths are moon worshippers, they come out, most of them, majority come out in the night. And butterflies are day flyers, most of them. Of course, like skippers, some of the skippers, they come early mornings or evenings. They come like Plum Judy, like last week. Plum Judy was in the evening at 7:30, just flying. And then I got a Facebook, I saw that 2 years ago, the same time I had photographed a Plum Judy in June 30th. And this time also last week in June, and I got this Plum Judy again in my garden. And Plum Judy was there. So Plum Judys are possibly little crepuscular, means they fly early mornings or late evenings. Skippers also fly late evenings and early morning. Many of them as early as something 5:30, you know, early morning or late evenings. And then we have, but most of butterflies are diurnal in a proper sense. They have to have the basking and then they start flying. And moths also are usually, as a rule, they're nocturnal. They avoid being seen in the daytime. But there are day flyer flying moths also, as pretty or prettier than butterflies also at times. And they fly like butterflies. So you have to look at their antenna, which is actually the deciding factor. And you see the moths. These are different kinds of moths I'm just showing. That they are the way they look, they're different. So once you know that what you're seeing is not a butterfly and a moth, and then look at the antenna actually. Antenna usually, the butterflies usually, all butterflies have usually a hair-like antenna, but always swollen at the tip, or there's a knob at the tip, or there's a hook at the tip. You know, the skippers, I got hook at the tip. So that's where you look, and that's the butterfly. And usually moths have got hairy antenna, but they are not knobbed at the end or swollen at the tip. Or they can have feathery antenna, agdi zupkedar misha astat. And they have partly they are feathery, partly not. Sometimes only one side is feathery. So a different diversity of antenna you'll find only in moths, not in butterflies. Butterflies are very simple lives they live. So, and you know, usually we associate butterflies with flowers, and you know, we are so naive. We didn't realize that even that butterflies, some of the butterflies you'll be surprised that they don't even know the existence of flowers. Like some butterflies don't come on flowers, like nawabs, rajas, and some of the butterflies. They rather prefer a dead crab or a dead frog on the road, killed, or a snake killed in the road, or urine, sweat, dung. You go in the forest, they'll sit on you for sucking up the sweat on you. So that is what they actually look for, because some of the butterflies need salts, many of them. And that's, you see the mud puddling happening, that I'll show you why they do it. But of course, a lot of butterflies do come for flowers, and that is the major job. Many butterflies are the important pollinators of flowers, and that causes a lot of the preparation, you know, these pollinators are very, very important, and every flower has got its own pollinator. Like, you know, butterfly or bees, I'd gone to Valley of Flowers and I saw so many, you know, beautiful flowers flowering, different colors and sizes, big, small, but there were no butterflies there. Why? And a lot of people ask me, are you, I'd gone to Valley of Flowers, ek bhi butterfly dekha nahi hai. So basically, kya hai ki, you know, those flowers are not butterfly flowers. There are very few butterfly flowers there. Butterfly flowers are different. They are more bunchy, small tubulars, and not the open flowers. Like, they are fly flowers or bee flowers. So they were more bee flowers. You'll see more bumblebees there in Valley of Flowers. So, you know, every flower has got a pollinator. Like, there are bat flowers, there are moth flowers, and there are bird flowers. Like, you have the silk, red silk cotton. They are bird flowers. And there are mammals also come to, like bats come in the night, you know, some of the evening flowering, big, like silk cotton, the white silk cotton blooms in the evening. And you see the bats coming there and clamoring for nectar. So each flower is made for each other, the pollinator, and that, and that's what, there are butterfly flowers. And of course, colors, actually, the colors are one which actually if we fall in love with, you know, the colors, and you'll be surprised that some colors are there and some colors are not there at all. It's just an illusion, like, you know. Like, you see the colors on the, when it rains, you see the petrol on water, it gives an iridescent color. Or you see the soap bubbles on, in the color, the iridescence you see on the soap bubbles. So that is the structural colors, is refracted colors you see, the kind of, is caused by the play of light on the surfaces. So butterfly scales also have certain surfaces and ridges that play on your eyes, and that gives you an illusion of colors. The colors don't exist. So here you see on my left, the glassy blue bottle, it has got real colors. They are not structural colors. But on my right, you see the peacock, common peacock. You see the iridescence, all that shine is structural. It is not but the color is not pigment, but it's caused by the refraction and reflection of lights, of cutting down certain wavelengths, and you see only certain wavelengths. So that is how these, they have one actual pigment and some are structural colors. They don't, this is all illusion, you'd see, not real. And of course, flowering plants, and the arrival of flowering plants is one that triggered also, that's the time when the butterflies evolved. And that's why many butterflies actually go for nectar. They're pollinators, they grow, they have evolved together. And they also lay eggs on some of these plants. And they don't lay eggs on ferns. You know why? Because ferns were first to arrive on the evolution scene, but not the flowering plants. So obviously they are co-evolved together and they are made for each other actually, butterflies and plants. And you'll be surprised that I learned my botany with butterflies. I've done my actually arts, I've done my political science and psychology, but butterflies taught me botany. You ask a butterfly what is common between a kadi patta, lemon and bale. Kadi patta, bale and lemon, you ask a botanist, he'll say belongs to Rutaceae family. And a common mormon will lay eggs only on Rutaceae family, that is kadi patta, bale or lemon. So butterflies are the best botanist and they can teach you. And I learned my botany through butterflies only. So around the world, if you see, there are about something like 1,74,250 species of butterflies and moths. You know, usually we keep on finding new species also. They keep numbers add, keep on adding. And out of those, there are 18,000 are butterflies around the world. And rest are all moths. So you can imagine moths are almost 10 times than butterflies. And India has got, India politically, you could say, India has got about 1,320 species. They keep on to 24, 26 also. We keep on discovering new species every time. Last week only, there was a publication where we found two new species. So that adds to it. So it possibly now it is 1,324 or 26. So that happens. It keep on happening. And butterflies are basically, you know, the biologists have classified butterflies into six families. And we have those six families in India. Those are basically skippers, swallowtail. I'll talk about it. I'll show them the pictures also. Whites and yellows, blues, judies and punches. And then we have the brush-filled butterflies, the nymphalids. So these are the six groups of butterfly families. And we'll explore that now. So we start with swallowtail butterfly, very handsome, very beautiful, and one of the largest butterflies we have in India. So we have common jay, which is very common in city. Both common rose and common jay is found. And in yesterday, only one common rose emerged in my window garden. I have planted some Aristolochia creepers on my windowsill, and it had caterpillars had pupated, and it emerged. So these are swallowtails, and look at the hind wing of the common rose. You know, the common rose hind wing is extended like a swallowtail. Swallow is a bird actually, and they have the long tails. And that name has the hind wing has got a swallow-like tails. You know, that's what it's called, swallowtail butterflies. Of course, all swallowtail butterflies don't have that kind of extended tails like the common jay here, you see. Common jay doesn't have that. The hind wing is slightly pointed, but is not as pointed or extended as common rose. So that's the difference. And you can look at the red body of the common rose. You know, that is maybe it's pretty to you, but it's basically warning color. These bright colors in nature are warning. Because when this common rose was a caterpillar, it fed on poisonous plants like Aristolochia. And that caterpillar can not only digest the poison, but that poison was assimilated in the body. And when it emerged from the pupa, that poison still is there in its adult body. And whenever an inexperienced bird happens to attack this slow move, and these distasteful species, I don't call them poisonous species because they're intended to kill. They are distasteful. They're here to learn, to teach a lesson to the predators, basically. So whenever an inexperienced bird happens to attack this slow flying, you know, brightly colored butterfly, it comes in contact with the body juices of the butterfly, and then the poison, the toxin that the common rose had eaten during the caterpillar stage comes into action. And the bird starts vomiting, gets nausea, heart palpitations, and gets so scared and vomits out that butterfly. Of course, these butterflies are very tenacious, actually. Even a small peck or even a catching doesn't really harm them. They recover, actually, this distasteful species. Because they have that kind of provision. that the body is more leathery and more tough. And that, but that bird will never again touch that common rose or so similar color butterflies. That's why we have mimicry also to take the advantage of this. And then we come to skippers. Skippers also are often mistaken for moths, and they're, you know, they have the hooked tips. You can see that the antenna are actually slightly swollen at the end, but they're hooked also. That's a very typical of the hook, skippers. And they have very long proboscis, and they're very good pollinators. Skippers either fold their wings behind, and those which spread out are called flats usually. But there are different kinds of names, bobs, aces, and angles. You'll go crazy, but don't worry. It's a slow learning. You know, even today also I get confused. So it's nothing I call myself expert or anything. No, it's learning. You can make mistakes, and nothing wrong if you make mistakes. Even I accept my mistakes many times, and maybe people expect you, you know, expert should not make mistakes. It's nothing like I'm not expert. I mean, I'm slightly more experienced than you guys are. So it's okay. You can pick up. And then we have these whites and yellows. Of course, you have seen the common grass yellow, which is often seen at the grasses, though it doesn't have any connection with the grass as such, with, besides flying among the grass level on the roadside. And then we have the common Jezebel, very pretty butterfly flying slowly, but again the bright colors means warning colors. It has got the plant poisons of the parasitic plant, the dendrobium or the mistletoe that grows on the mango or other plants as a parasite. That is the host plant for the Jezebel. That's why Jezebel keeps on flying at the tree level, the females, to look out for plants to lay eggs on. Then we come to small blues. Those are very small. The blues are very small. Though all butterflies are not bluer, but many of them, when they open the wings, they're blue. The males usually have blues. That's why it's called blues. So we have a common cerulean and hedge blues. And some of them have a tail at the hind wing and a false eye. You know, that basically a decoy to distract, to deflect the predator's attention towards the less vulnerable part of the body. You know, sar salamat to pagdi pachas. It's like that. Is trying to divert. If the attack is there, attack should be on the tail end, and it's more brighter. And in the, and when you approach your cerulean, it keeps on moving the hind wings to, you know, to attract the predator attention. So basically, this is a defense decoy. Then we come to Judies and Punches. And Judies, of course, we have the Plum Judy. Plum Judy was always there here, and then somebody found out that this Judies were, you know, were two different Judies. One is the which has got a one straight band, and one is slightly so that other straight band is rather rarer, and it is found mainly in South India and some part in Kerala and some, and then it is found in Northeast, in Assam and other places in Northeast. But that's that the band is more straighter. So it's a straight Judy, and this is a Plum Judy, which you always had a Plum Judy in Mumbai, you'll see them, but it doesn't come out in the sun. It's always seen under, moving under the leaves and under shrubs and other trees where bird droppings are there, rotten fruits have fallen, overripe fruits have fallen. So you'll find them flying, and it always keeps his wings half open. Punches you don't find in South India. Punches you have to see to go to North India, Northeast, and Uttarakhand and all these places you can go. And you can certainly find purpose. The Northeast is full of different kinds of punches. You have striped punches, you have got orange punches, and you have got lesser punches. So plenty of punches you can see. And these are another smaller group of butterflies, which earlier, you know, grouped together with the blues, but now they're separated. And this is a sixth group. The sixth group is the nymphalid, or the brush-footed butterflies. They're called brush-footed butterflies because being an insect, they have six legs, but the four front two legs actually are used very short and not grow fully developed, but they have brush-like structures on their tips. And that for two legs in the front are used to clean up their antenna, their face, when they're covered with pollen and dust. So that is how they use the four legs. And these butterflies walk on four legs, four, one, two, three, four. And the front two legs are used for cleaning up their faces and antenna. So that's why they are called brush-footed butterflies. That's a beautiful gaudy baron on the right, and that's a baronet. Both are very common around Mumbai, Thane, Pune region. And baronets are basically lay eggs on tendu trees, leaves. You can see in the month of May and the summer is very active. Now also till half of monsoon it will be active, then it will slightly reduce, maybe with too much of rains it doesn't like. Gaudy baron, you know, is a totally found in most part of Mumbai and region also. Wherever there are the parasitic plants, it lays eggs on parasitic plants like mistletoes. Just like the Jezebel, it lays eggs on the parasitic plants. And any rotten fruits will draw this butterfly like mad. It goes crazy over the rotten fruits. Now let's see, why we have this kind of diversity of butterflies. Like you go to England and ask them how many species they have. They'll really proudly say 47 species. And ask us Indians, how many species you have, guys? You'll say 1,320 or more. So you can see this kind of diversity we have. That's because, see the map here, the diversity map I'm showing you, because we have this biogeographic zones, the colorful biogeographic zones. You see the Himalayas, Kashmir and Arunachal has got the Himalayas. And then we have the deserts also. We have the Central Indian deciduous forest also. Then we have the Western Ghats, again a hotspot. Then the Northeast is another hotspot for butterflies. So these are the two hotspots, the Northeast and the Western Ghats. Sahyadris are the basically hotspots. And then they have the Andaman Islands where you have certain species endemic. Andaman Islands and Western Ghats are where you have more endemic species. Some butterflies are found only in Sahyadris and nowhere else in the world, or in Andamans and nowhere else in the world. So that is what makes it very unique. And that's what for butterflies, India has been a butterfly destination, because we are one of the 17 mega diverse countries put together. We have lions, tigers, elephants. So that not many countries have this kind of fauna, because we have a rich land and that supports a good forest. And that is what we have to protect. That's a big job, boss. So let's start with our journey from Trans-Himalaya, that is beyond Himalayas. Of course, now this has been on the news, Ladakh area, where you have the Chinese on the other side. This area is totally, like a cold desert. Like hardly any trees grow there, actually. Whatever the trees are there, like juniper or pine, they hardly grow above your knee. They're very, very broad dwarfs. And most of the areas are quite barren. They have the lakes too. But the lakes are brackish. They are not freshwater lakes. They are brackish. Possibly once upon a time when it is believed that this was under the Tithi Sea. The Himalayas were under Tithi Sea. And that's why you can sometimes find fossils, shell fossils on the Himalayas. And that's why you still have the remnants, brackish lakes. The salt is still present very much there in the soil. And that causes the brackish lakes in Himalayas. And that's where your migratory birds actually breed there in July, August, and they come in winter after the breeding is over. And snow leopard, of course, this is not photographed in Ladakh or any, this was photographed in Darjeeling Zoo. And that's a top predator in Ladakh. Not tiger, or lion or elephant, but the snow leopard, specially adapted to survive in the harsh weather of Ladakh. But there are butterflies also there in Ladakh, and you'll be surprised. And you can see a desert too in Ladakh, the Nubra desert. I was also amazed to see a desert right in the Himalayas. And this is the Nubra desert where the Mongolians and the other trade used to happen between India and the Chinese and the Tibetans and the Mongolians. And this is where even the Alexander possibly came. And that is the only remnant is now the camels. And these camels are bacterian camels. They're double hump camels, not the camels we see in Rajasthan or Gujarat. Or sometimes the zoo, but these are bacterial camels, and they are there, possibly the remnants of the trade which these traders brought. And we can have a ride there also. So this Dumbra desert, and this is also a place where you can see some butterflies found only here only, nowhere else. And that's also where you can see the Kiang, or the Tibetan wild ass, an amazing animal, very handsome, very strong. It gallops at a speed where you can't match, because first of all, if you go to Ladakh, you have to lie on the bed for one day, getting you acclimated as yourself. Because you start walking around, the moment you arrive, you feel nothing. But then you start feeling headache, you'll feel nausea, you might even fall sick so much that you'll have to go back to Delhi. So you have to first acclimatize your body for that kind of altitude where it's rarefied air, oxygen is less. But these animals are adapted, the lungs are so powerful, they can run at a speed. So you can imagine the kind of lung power they have. And the blood that can assimilate oxygen at that fast rate. So that's where I But I was actually looking for another, I was in Ladakh for a different reason, because I was looking for butterflies called Apollos. And Apollos are found only about 10,000 feet in Himalayas. And you can't find them. So that's why I was in Leh and Ladakh. And here you see the blue arrow here on the top right, bottom right. And that was the first time I saw this butterfly. I was overjoyed because this is what I wanted. And basically, I was that time writing the book on butterflies. And I could have easily written BNH's library. BNH's library has got all the references, all the books. And there's a collection of preserved butterflies. So why go anywhere? Just sit there and write the book. It's so easy. Copy from the books and refer for the journals. So easy. But no, I wanted to actually see these butterflies, watch those butterflies in natural habitat, photograph them. Then only I thought, I decided to write a book. But that took me 10 years for my first book. It took 10 years because, writing about them to see those places, it's a long process. So, but I believe that you have to first see your subject well, study them in the field, and then writing makes much sense. And that's where I saw this beautiful butterfly is called Red Apollo and the Regal Apollo. And they're very slow moving. They fly and, very leisurely in the Ladakh. And this the common Red Apollo I found at the Rohtang, at the highest motorable road. On about I think that was around 18,000 feet. And then this Regal Apollo I found much at lower altitudes, but around 10,000 at nearly. But the Red Apollo, I had to go up at our 18,000 feet to find this. The Khardumla Pass is the highest motorable road in world, supposed to be one of the road. And there I was found this common Red Apollo and happily flying. And then it just settled just in front of me on the road, basking. My God, I was so thrilled. And then I started clicking like crazy. Of course, there are other butterflies like whites, also yellow. These are basically, and these fauna is different. It's not the oriental fauna that we find in India on the plains. This is more towards European-like fauna, the Palearctic fauna. Like India is a meeting of Indo-Malayan fauna coming from the northeast. Then we have Arabian fauna coming from the western area. And then we have the endemic fauna in the south. So this kind of, India is sort of a melting pot for all these faunas coming from different regions, from the northeast, from the west, and then from the top, we have this Palearctic, European-like fauna. So even you go to Europe, you'll see the cabbage butterflies flying there also. The bath whites, some of these European and Eurasian areas, you can find them. So that's a large cabbage white and bath white. And then we had even the blues there. Some of the blues very common there, the common meadow blue, flying at 10,000 feet. And golden copper, which I had not seen, that was a lifer there. Because I went to Ladakh for a couple of times to see these butterflies. And these are very tiny butterflies, as small as your little fingernails. And the nympholids. Some of these butterflies I found at near Khardumla Pass, especially the Ladakh tortoise shell. Ladakh tortoise shell is found mainly in the Ladakh areas, in the high region, where there are other tortoise shells also, but they are found much lower. This is possibly the highest flying tortoise shell, and found only in that region. That's the reason the name is called Ladakh tortoise shell. Of course, now we cross over the Himalayas. We come to the wetter part of Himalayas and look at the change of the tree line. Your tree line really shoots up. You have the pine, juniper, the kind of deodars that you don't see in Ladakh. In this side, you cross over to the wetter part, to the more towards the southern part, and you see the difference in Himalayas. And you can see the ice-capped Himalayas where the rivers are born. And see the flora. The flora is different. The trees are different. The trees are different because they have to withstand extreme heat and extreme heat also, because you can get very hot there. You can burn your nose and skin. You have to always keep on sunscreen on your face and hands. And extreme cold. So you have different kinds of forests there. Pine and birch, and you have junipers and devdar. And rhododendrons. If you happen to go now also, you see some of the areas, especially from April, it starts flowering. The rhododendrons flower right from Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh. The entire Himalayas is set ablaze with these beautiful flowers of rhododendrons, and we have got more than 50 species of butterfly, 50 species of rhododendrons flowering in different parts of Himalayas, across right from Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh. It's an amazing sight, but you should go in the season of spring, that is from end March or April onwards, it starts flowering. And of course, you have balsam. Balsam you'll see now also. Now you go to trek in Sahyadris and in the little nearby mountains, you'll see balsam here also. But these are Himalayan mountains photographed in the Valley of Flowers. Balsams are very important. They've got this antibacterial property. And now that's the reason many of the face packs and all that Ayurvedic stuff is coming up based on our herbal plants. But that is also causing a problem because we've been taking up all these herbal plants, just robbing them with tons of truckloads of them. Maybe someday we'll not be left with these herbal plants for the herbal factories. And there you have this Himalayan black bear. Look at the bear. And I'm showing you the animals also along with the butterflies. Of course, this is also not taken in the wild, but a zoo. But just to show the animal that is found in that area. You know, this is not a sloth bear. Look at the look. The look is different. The sloth bear is more shaggy and the hairs are long. Here you have more trimmed hair and with a V-shape, very prominent mark. And look, the face is different. That's the Himalayan black bear. And of course, skippers are there flying in the Himalayas too. And you have the spotted snowflat. Snowflat, actually common snowflat flies in Maharashtra also, around down south of Sahyadris, you can find there. And in the northeast also, you can find this snowflats. There are different kinds of snowflats actually. And then we have the swifts. And this is called a straight swift. Why? Because look at the spots here. You have the spots here on the hind wing. There is a straight line, right? From it, as the spots goes up, the size of the spots are reduced. And they are in straight line. And that's how this swift, this butterfly gets the name, straight swift. And there are a group of swifts which have these kind of spots on the upper side. And that's how the ID is. Even it has to open its wings. And that's the best way to identify the skippers. And the snow flat, actually, this hind wing, you can see, the hind wing has got this white patch. That is because many of these skippers have got habit, you know, they are looking for bird droppings. For getting the salts. And rotting fruits are mainly bird droppings or mud puddling they do. But when they sit on a bird dropping, and bird dropping usually splashed on the leaves with a lot of urea, the white color is there on the leaves with the bird dropping. And when this butterfly sits among that bird dropping with a white splash, this white color helps the butterfly to become invisible on a bird dropping. So that's an adaptation has been, you know, because a result of their feeding habits, plain feeding habits. And then have the Himalayan darts there. These darts, we have got the dark palm darts in down in the plains in South India and other places. And then we have the gray vein, small hopper, as small as a little fingernail, and up in the Valley of Flowers, I had photographed it. And they have another beautiful blue Apollo, very beautiful, photographed in Great Himalayan National Park. When I was trekking in Great Himalayan National Park, you had to go from Kulu Manali area. And that's where I found the blue Apollo. And while I was photographing the blue Apollo, I also saw another blue, handsome swallowtail, the yellow swallowtail. This is a swallowtail you can find in Europe also. If you are trekking in Europe, you'll find there in the British Gardens also. And you can find in Russia also. So these are basically European species which are spread across. These are basically the Palearctic species, more Eurasian and Europe, Asian species. But found only in the Himalayas, they don't come down. So that's another speciality of this Palearctic fauna. And common blue Apollo is the lowest flying Apollo, possibly around 8,000 feet, but nothing below that. So some butterflies are found, like Apollos are only found, the altitude makes very important. In butterfly studies, actually, the altitude is very important to determine their habit distribution. And that's why some butterflies are found a certain altitude only, and also depends on the flora. Because that's a food plant. So that also is very important. And then we come these very beautiful looking butterflies flying very slowly, the great windmill and the common windmill. But again, they are red bodied. That means they are distasteful. Birds keep off from these butterflies, and they're these long tails and these bright colors, and they move very slowly. So birds, to ensure that the birds don't make any mistake, that and any peck will cause them immense nausea, vomiting. Of course, the predator will not die. They are not poisonous. They are distasteful. It causes them to vomit. The birds will vomit and suffer so much that never again they'll touch these butterflies. And they also look like each other. That's called a mimicry ring. It's called the Müllerian mimicry, not the Batesian mimicry. You know, every distasteful species look like each other. So either one of get, you know, attacked, the rest of the species get protected. That's how, you know, this tigers and crows together, they move like striped tiger or plain tiger. Then we have the crows looking like each other. So, you know, any of this member of this family gets color pattern gets pecked or eaten by birds, the predator learns a lesson and never again touch that color species. So that's how this is called the ring mimicry or the Müllerian mimicry. Now we come to the whites and yellows. Again, you have the great black wain there flying in the Himalayas. And this flower, thistle flower, you see, is very, very important. Whenever you go to Himalaya, just stand near this plant. It's flowering. You don't have to go anywhere. The lot of butterflies will come like crazy on this flower, the thistle. That's what I did. And I saw common brimstone also came here. Common brimstone is found in Europe also and in Central Asia also. And that's the butterfly that gave the name butterfly. You know, this is the first butterfly to fly at the first signs of spring. Because winters are very, very dead and very dull and very boring in Europe and Britain. So they look out for the signs of spring, you know, the new leaves and the flowers, where are they coming? They're waiting for the warmth. And the first sign of spring is seen when this brimstones start flying. And they call this butterfly. That's why you got a butterfly. And this is the Himalayan brimstone. Of course, though the name here, common brimstone, is given, but basically it's a Himalayan brimstone flying in the Himalayas. We have the common brimstone, actually, another species that flies in the Europe. And on the Himalayan meadows, you know, Himalayas have got forest of pine, but there are open patches of grassland, the meadows. And on there, you have different kinds of species of butterflies. These are the dark clouded yellows, different kinds of dark yellows. And they keep on flying, you know, endlessly, non-stop. Very difficult to photograph them also. Very rarely they'll come on a flower and you can photograph them. But they are the one fast flying butterflies found only in the high Himalayas. Of course, there is a Nilgiri clouded yellow also found in Nilgiris. That's only one there left, but rest are all in Himalayas. And then again, we come to the blues, small blues. You can find the hedge blues, also common hedge blues you can see in Western Ghats also, and other forests in the Eastern Ghats also. And then you have the orange bud Argus. Don't worry about the names, just I'm showing you what kind of butterflies see in Himalayas. And there are some butterflies which are not as bright as they should be because their habitat is different and they have to remain invisible. So you have the color pattern that breaks their body optically, so it can't be seen. So this white edge rock brown always stays among the rocks. So it has got this kind of pattern that makes it invisible. And they don't go for flowers, but they go for dead animal, rotting fruits, or some human sweat, dung, urine, animal dung, urine, man, even human being also. So they will go for that, but never on flowers. But this satyr is another dull butterfly that is found in the rocks. And it has got a strange habit of, you know, basking. You know, normally butterflies bask with open wings, but this butterfly will tilt on one side and bask, will not open the wings. Strange indeed. And then we have the beaks. You know, beaks are one which are very common in the Europe also, but we have about some beaks are found in the South Indian Nilgiris also. And those are the southern beak we have. And then we have the common beak and club beak in the Himalayas also. And Maharashtra are places, some of the hills in Karnataka, Maharashtra also, like Mathiram, and some of the areas near Alibag also has got beaks. But these were earlier thought to be very high altitude butterflies, but now they have come, now people have found them at much lower altitude. And you see that how you name the butterflies actually. Now this is a club beak, you can see the club here, on the top right, the club here marking on the forewing, club-like marking, this club beak. But in common beak, this club is broken. You see this, the club is broken here in the bottom right is the club broken, and top left is the club intact. That's a club beak and that's a common beak. That's how these markings actually help in identifying the butterflies. So markings are very important in identification of butterflies. Now we come to another forest, that is subtropical forest. Let's see what's in these animals. The red panda. Of course, this is also a zoo photograph. And red pandas are the tree-dwelling, you know, bear cats. And there also you see the different kinds of skippers. That's a green owlet, very beautiful skipper. And you have the flats, much larger than the common snow flat. And then we have the blues, the sapphires. My God, they're so beautiful. The colors you see are so pretty. They look like pretty earrings. And these are again the structural colors. So they're not real colors, but caused by the structural color structures of the scales. That's the structural color they have. That's a golden sapphire and that's a green sapphire. The females are not as bright as the males. They are more brown with orange stripes. And then we have the nympholids there. You see the eastern courtier. We have western courtier also in the western Himalayas. And in the eastern Himalayas, we have the eastern courtier. And you see the male is on the right and the female, the male is on the left and the female is on the right. Female is more rare, not found out in the open, but male is more common. Female usually is seen around the food plants, host plants also only. Then we have lovely handsome butterfly, the last silver stripe, very beautiful butterfly, very conspicuously seen around the Himalayas, eagle nest you go or Sikkim you go. You can see them. And then we have the purple emperor. Again, very conspicuous butterfly. And here you see the how the light plays on the scales. You know, every time the butterfly changes the angle, you see different hues of blues, you know, different shades of blue. Well, that's a structural color. The color doesn't exist. But because of the refraction of light, you see that kind of colors. As I showed, these are the structural colors. Now we come to Ramganga River, foothills of Himalayas. Let's see what you see in this forest. Now you see the forest has changed. The leaves, the trees are different. They're broadleaf, no pine, no juniper, no deodar. They're different. There are more sal and other trees are there. Let's see what are those. And let's see gharial. Now you see in the Ramganga River, you see the gharial. Rather endangered crocodile, we have got three crocodiles. We have got the mugger and the saltwater crocodile. And then we have the fish eating crocodile, that is gharial. And of course, now you see the elephants now. You didn't see elephant top then in Himalayas, but you have to come down because they require a huge flower forest and they have to keep on moving because if they stay at one place, they'll eat up the forest and destroy the forest. And that's why elephants migrate. You know, migration is very important to help the forest because elephants, if you stay at one place, they keep on eating and they'll destroy the forest. So that's why they need to move. And we have seen that, but elephants move from Kerala up to Maharashtra sometimes. Earlier they used to come, but you know, Maharashtra has got no elephants. Why? Nobody killed them. It's only the forests in Maharashtra are not good enough to support elephant population. That's the thing. That's why we don't have tiger in Sanjay Gandhi National Park. Why? Because the forest is not healthy enough to support a tiger. It's not that somebody's killed it. And now you see, we are in Tarai. Tarai is the foothills of Himalayas. You see the silk cotton there like we have in Mumbai, another region, silk cotton and other species of trees here. The trees are different and the forest is different. These are Tarai. Tarai is the foothills. And you have the golden langur there. It's a beautiful animal found on the Bhutan border, Bhutan-Assam border, discovered as late as, recent as 1957, almost 63 years ago. And we have the Indian rhino. That's another mascot of the Northeast. So these are the animals we have. You know, that's the biodiversity we have. This, not every country has this kind of biodiversity. So we are rich. And that makes us so different from other countries, and we are so rich, we have got so much diversity. You name it and we have it. And orchids, Northeast and Sahyadri, the Western Ghats, are full of different species of orchids. You name it. And March, April, May is the best place to see the orchids. And some flower, and now some of the ground orchid will start flowering now with the rains, the habin areas. And this is the forest. This is a forest of here, not of Brazil or Amazon, but forest of Arunachal Pradesh. And even you go to South India, the Western Ghats, the Parambikulam National Park, some of the Karnataka, even Maharashtra also, some of the forests are so beautiful. The clouds come, these are cloud forests. So beautiful and so rich. And you have the hornbills here. Hornbills are found in South India also, Western Ghats. And this is the wreath hornbill found in the Northeast. And hornbills require huge trees, not to nest on the trees, but inside the trees. Not like, they don't nest like crows. They have to nest inside. So you require huge trees to nest inside the trees. And that's very important. These are flagship species. You know, when you study the health of the forest, you have to study what are the flagship species are, like tigers, elephants, hornbills, some of the butterflies. So that tells you the health of the forest, if the forest is good or bad. You know, presence and absence of these species actually indicate the health of the habitat. And here you have the butterflies too, the all king, very handsome butterfly. But these butterflies always have a habit of sitting below the leaf. So many times you don't see some of the butterflies, you never see them also because they don't come and sit on top of the leaf or on the flowers, but they're usually below the leaves and they feed on dead animals, rotting fruits or human sweat and dung, but never on flowers. And then we have the great swift. That's another beautiful butterfly. We have conjoined swift here in Western Ghats. But there you have it in, that's called Assam swift or great swift. And these markings, you know, these yellows, these white spots here, actually the way they are joined or not joined, present, and these kind of spots actually help in the identification of skippers. And among the butterflies, skippers are one of the most difficult species to identify. It takes time for you to learn. Even I get confused sometimes. And then have these beautiful swallowtail butterflies. Look at those dragon tails. We have the left is the white dragon tail and the right is the green dragon tail. You see the greenish patch here. And the difference is actually the border of the forewing, the black border in the white dragon tail, the border of this forewing actually see it expands toward the apex. Here it is almost in the green dragon, almost equal. The border is almost equal throughout. That's the difference between green dragon tail and the white dragon tail. And there's another beautiful butterfly called the Bhutan Glory. You know, Bhutan Glory I saw in Eagle Nest as well as in Zero when I went to for the butterfly meet there. And another beautiful, of course, we have Kaiser Hind also. I'm not have the photograph here, but Kaiser Hind is one of the rarest of the rare, which is found in Thale. If you happen to go to Zero, that's the only place you can see Kaiser Hind also. And you can see Bhutan Glory also. And a lot of several rare butterflies in Zero, in the Thale Wildlife Sanctuary. And another handsome butterfly is a five-bar swordtail. Down south, if you go to Goa, down south of Amboli, you can see this five-bar swordtail. In Karnataka, Kerala, you can see. And again, in northeast, you can see this beautiful, handsome swordtail. These are swordtail butterflies. Very handsome, very beautiful. And then we have the chain swordtail. Just like spot swordtail we see, a chain swordtail is found in the northeast. The difference between, you know, this kind of the chain, the you see this line of markings here, like a chain on the forewing. I'm drawing the cursor there. You can see my cursor going up and down on the extreme left, the chain swordtail. The spot swordtail has got spots and not this kind of linked like a chain. And then we have the veined, we have the common jay. So here you have veined jay, which is found in northeast. And then we have the golden birdwing. Look at the golden birdwing, and the difference is, look at the border here. The border of the hindwing is dusted. Dusted with tiny dark scales. That is the key of the golden birdwing. The common birdwing also flies there, but doesn't have this kind of border here. The border is there, but it is always clean, not dusted with this kind of dark scale. So that's the difference. And the female here, female is much, you know, it has got more white on the wings, forewings. The common birdwing doesn't have that kind of more white on the wings. That's the difference. That's a female are larger than the males. And recently, you know, Peter Smetacek, I saw him that he says that actually the largest butterfly in India is not the southern birdwing, but it is actually the golden birdwing, which is, it comes almost 194 mm and not 190 or 180 of the southern birdwing. So possibly, maybe we'll have to see that. But according to him, possibly golden birdwing is the largest butterfly in India and not the southern birdwing. So it needs to be checked again. Then we come to the whites and yellows, you know, beautiful. You know, Jezebels are so pretty, especially on the left side, you see the red spot Jezebel, the hill Jezebel. In South India, you see only one Jezebel, the common Jezebel. And in the Eastern Ghats, especially, you can see the painted Jezebel also at some places, though rare, but you can see in Andhra Pradesh and Eastern Maharashtra, you can see this, the painted Jezebel also. And these Jezebels are distasteful, but birds don't attack this butterfly. And taking the advantage of that, some of the butterflies like sawtooths that mimic these butterflies, and they also escape from being attacked because they look like this butterfly. They are not distasteful. They don't harbor any poisons or toxins in the body, but they look like the Jezebel and they escape. That's called the mimicry. And then we have the silver lines, blues, and then we have the punches. The punches are found only in the northeast and north, not in South India. And these are the silver line. You can see this line here in the central, in the left top. That's the long band here. That's why the name long banded silver line. The band is totally almost continuous, you know, it's not broken and continuous. And other band also meets here. That's important. The two bands meet here. So that's the key to identification. Whereas you can see this is all silver line. But this band, the middle band is broken here. It doesn't reach here. This band reaches here. That's the long band. And this is called a club silver line. Why? Because the club here pattern, you see near the forewing, the base that is here, the club-like pattern is there near the head. This club-like. Here the club is there, but it is not isolated. It is attached to another band. Here it is it's single and unattached. So that's the club silver line. That's how the names are given. There's a striped punch, and that's the orange punch. When it opens, more orange. That's why the name orange punch. You know, all these names, actually, the common names, were given by the Britishers. And you'll be surprised that when the British came to India, they went crazy. You know, that's the time when butterfly collecting was like stamp collecting. What do you collect stamps now? That's a hobby. They should catch butterflies, kill them, pin them, and put them in the showcases, in the cabinet boxes. And that's where they studied also butterflies. Seriously, Evans and Winter Blythe and all these people, they studied seriously. And a lot of information on Indian butterflies were published during that time. So, and that's that the names also, the common English names were given during that time. Like the commander, sailor, you know, the commodores, all were because the British officers were all, they'll give the names of the ranks. And these names are still today also they are used. All the names, the common names which are used are published names by BNHS in Evans. Evans was identification but published by BNHS. Then Winter Blythe's book also was published by BNHS. And these are common standard names. And these common standard names are also used in other countries like Sri Lanka, then Northie in Singapore, Malaysia, Pakistan. So these are the common names. And we have to use the names which are already published. And you can't start using any common. There's no rules on using common names. You can name anything. You can call a butterfly king cobra also, because no one will stop you. But you have to use common names which are actually published in a proper journal or been accepted by general public with the community. So it has to be published in a book or in a journal and accepted by peer-reviewed journals. That's very important. Now we come to nymphalid. You have the striped blue crow. Look at the crow here. These crows are also, again, northeast, you know, all these crows, blue crows, northeast and some of the north area, but never in south. Striped blue crow does occur in the Eastern Ghats, and you can find them in Andhra Pradesh, bit of Andhra Pradesh and bit of Tamil Nadu also, but that's very rare in the Eastern Ghats. But most of these crows are blue there, it's amazing colors. And the female here, is the bottom left, is a female of the blue crow. And then you have the palm flies. You know, see, look at the variety of palm flies they have in northeast. You know, I go crazy when I go to Northeast, and Northeast, I have to go every year. This time also, I was there in March, just before the lockdown. I was in Arunachal Pradesh, where we had this butterfly meet of the Northeast. And we had lovely session. We had a lot of people from South India, from Calcutta, from Maharashtra also. We had a lot of people from there. And we had a good time in the Arunachal Pradesh. And that's the time we saw this Jezebel palm fly also, and the tiger palm fly. So that kind of diversity we have Northeast. You know, there are more than 900 species occur only in the Northeast. And we've got 330 species plus on the Sahyadri. So these are the best hotspots for butterflies. If you want to watch butterflies, you should go to these places. And then, you know, some butterflies actually, you have to see them in the dark jungles. You know, in Arunachal Pradesh, where we have to actually enter dark jungles, very dark, deep, dense jungles, and you can see them. But these jungles are infested with leeches, you know. And you have to wear leech socks. But when it rains, the leeches will start raining from the top. They fall on the on your body from the trees, and they'll enter your shirt. And it's very difficult. You know, when summer, you have ticks biting you. And otherwise, when it rains, there are full of the land becomes alive with leeches. Even Mathiran, if you go to Mathiran, in rains, it's full of leeches. Amboli also got leeches. So leeches are there in some of the butterfly places. Of course, in Mahabaleshwar, we don't have leeches, but Mathiran has got leeches, Amboli has got leeches. And so as in Arunachal, especially, there are big, big leeches. And they follow you if you're this raining. But usually you wear leech guards, and these butterflies are dark in dark jungles. You go and you see suddenly this flash of blue flies in front of you. It was there sitting, you'll not see it till it flies. That's a flash coloration. And another beautiful butterfly, striped ringlet, again in the dark, deep jungles. And these butterflies are very, very fussy and specific, because they require real good forest. And now we come to the Sundarbans, the forest. And that's place where you have to go and travel in boat. You can stay in boat only. You're not allowed to walk because there is tiger there. And tiger is very different. This time we saw tiger because it's come on a hunt. Actually, we saw tiger hunting a deer. It almost caught the deer, but this time deer was lucky and it escaped. But I had come for a different tiger. That is a white tiger. This butterfly looks like a striped tiger, but look at the hind wings. Hind wings are different. That's a white tiger. found only in Sundarbans and Odisha, in the mangrove region, Odisha and Sundarbans. And I had come there to photograph this tiger. Finally, after a couple of visits, I found this white tiger there and I was very happy. And that's, you know, some butterflies are found only in specific regions only. So that's why you're, that's what took me to all these different corners of India and showed me India. Otherwise, I never traveled. In search of butterflies, I discovered India. And of course, Sundarbans, you have huge crocodiles. These are saltwater crocodiles. As this was almost like 20 feet plus, right there, staring at 10 feet. But very, you know, so far you are in the boat, you can watch it and photograph it as much as you want. But the saltwater, the salties. And of course, the ghorpad. Of course, this is not the Tanaji Maluxeres ghorpad, the common ghorpad, but this is the ghorpad from, this is water monitor, Varanus salvator, found only in the Sundarbans and Odisha, not found in other parts of India. And it stays in mangrove areas, actually feeding on crabs, birds, anything that it can overpower and eat. And you have birds there, some of these brown-winged kingfishers and so much of colored kingfishers. And you have nothing but, nothing is there. It can be boring day sometimes and you can find crabs there. Crabs are also important. See the fiddler crabs, you know, chasing the rival in the away from the territory. And then we from the eastern coast, we are now coming to the western border of Pakistan. You know, we are in Thar Desert, Rajasthan, right there, beautiful desert here. But here also you have butterflies. You know, we have the Arabs here, the large Arab here. You can see in different places like Bharatpur, you can see in Delhi, you can see them. You can see in down south also, in Maharashtra, you can see them. Also where the dry regions are there. So these butterflies are of a dry region. Not only Rajasthan, but different areas in as south, as Tamil Nadu also, you can see them in dry places, Andhra Pradesh. Then we have the small orange tip also here, very pretty butterfly. And now we come to central India, the land of the tiger. And you see the forest is tall and beautiful. And this is a deciduous forest of sal trees, not the sag, not the teak, but the sal. And here you have the tiger. You know, India is the only country where you can see tiger at 10 feet away from your open gypsy. Nowhere in the world. This is our monopoly. And tiger is surviving. Elsewhere, you go to Malaysia, you go to Indonesia, where tigers were there, they are all gone, all eaten by Chinese and gone for Chinese medicine. Only tiger remains safe in Nepal partly. Very difficult to see in Nepal, but here you is guaranteed. Like, you know, go to Bandhavgarh, Tadoba, the best place near Nagpur. And our Corbett also is good, but sometimes you might not see tigers there. There are good tigers there, but Kana, Bandhavgarh, Tadoba is the best place to tiger. Of course, you can go to Kabini also down south, different good places. But here is India, where the forest department has to be given the credit, because they are the one who have saved the tiger. And India is going to, and tiger today is an industry. It is not just a tiger, because so much of livelihood depends on tiger. The hotel business is there, tourism is there, attracting so much tourism. So this is very important. The wildlife is giving a livelihood to people. And that is the final key to conservation. If people benefit from wildlife, they will stop killing, they'll stop destroying, because if it fetches them for livelihood, why not? And of course, you'll be surprised that some of the birds found in forest, they have the, you look at the bills, and majority birds don't eat dal, chawal and, you know, grains. They are basically insectivorous birds, and they're very important species which actually control the insect population, and they're the friends of the farmers. So encouraging birds around the farms are very important, so you can reduce pesticides and encourage more birds to control the insect population. And we can stop poisoning ourselves by, you know, using more pesticides. So birds are so important around it. And now we come to the striped tiger striped tiger that is very common around India. And it is very slow. Again, it is a distasteful species. Birds don't eat this butterfly. Don't attack or eat this butterfly. Even the plain tiger is distasteful. But you see, what are the butterflies are doing? They are mud puddling. They are on a damp patch, you know, sucking up the moisture. Why? And you'll be surprised, they're all males, because they are seeking a dowry. They're collecting a dowry they have to pay to the female. That's the salt. Because females don't get salt in the nectar. So these salts are very important for the viable, for being eggs being viable while she lays eggs. The salt is very essential. And where does she get the salt? Who's to bring the salt? The males have to bring the salts. And these salts will be passed on to the female during the mating. And that's why you see, when these males congregate, they keep on pushing each other and shoving each other, because they want as much as salt as they can, because it's the saltiest male will who will get the female. The female will choose the saltiest male, the guy who has got the most salts, the richest guy. So now we come to the Western Ghats of Sahyadris, and you can see the mountain range, very important mountain range we have, which is where the rivers are born, the fresh water, the source of fresh water, the rivers are born. This mountain range is not for birds and butterflies, but for our future, especially those living at the plains and other areas. The mountains are very important for us because they are where the rivers are born, and fresh water is very important to for civilization to survive. Many civilizations have lost after the rivers are gone. So rivers are very important and we have to protect them. And now the cities like Mumbai, you know, we know in Mumbai, there's no river or there's no lake also. We can take a bucket of water and go and fetch. Lakes are far off somewhere in the forest, like Tulsi and Vihar in the forest. So fresh water is so much important and very essential for us. And that's why we need to protect this kind of catchment areas and the eco-sensitive zones, because for our future, not for birds and butterflies only. And then we have the Shekru, or the state animal of Maharashtra, the giant squirrel. And this again is a forest dweller, lives on the canopy level, you know, doesn't come on the ground. So these kind of animals are very specific and they indicate the health of the forest. And then you have the prince of the jungle, the leopard. Of course, you have the Bombay, you have more leopard too. And leopard has come in conflict with humans here also sometimes, because you know, the Sanjay Gandhi National Park, you look at the map, it looks like an isolated by totally in an island, all surrounded by human population. And we are encroached on their habitats. So obviously, leopards are going to come in conflict with human beings. But yes, they are tenaciously surviving in Sanjay Gandhi National Park today also. And we have the southern bird wing. Of course, I was discussing about this, that the southern bird wing is the largest, or the golden bird wing, as recently Peter Smedacek has mentioned that possibly golden bird wing is largest and not the southern bird wing, but it's a female that is supposed to be the largest butterfly, about 180 mm, or it goes up to 190 sometimes. So that possibly the largest butterfly we have in south of Maharashtra onwards, or Sahyadri, you will find is endemic to South India only, the southern bird wing. And then we have the smallest butterfly called a grass jewel. Very small, almost 12 mm, smaller than your little finger's nail. See, this is the smallest butterfly in India. Very common if you see along the roadside, passing by. You can see them in summer especially, or just after the monsoon, you can see. And then with the commander. Commander is another handsome butterfly. You know, as I was telling them, these names were given by the British officers who studied butterflies seriously. They collected butterflies. And that's why the commander, commodore, sailors, sergeants were given by this British officer. These are the common names which are used world over. The specific, and we have to use those common names. And then have a beautiful butterfly, the Malabar banded peacock. You know, I was in Samilan Shetty's butterfly park in Belwaya, that is Karnataka, near Mangalore. And there we went for an outing, and there he took to a place where all these clerodendron, the pagoda plant, was flowering along the roadside. And there were these Malabar banded peacocks. My God, we went crazy. For more than an hour, we were photographing them. And that also was not enough. And they kept on coming and we kept on photographing. And imagine the colors are so brilliant. And this is the endemic butterfly found only in South India. So that makes it more vulnerable and endangered. But look at the colors. And then we have another endangered and rare butterfly called a tree nymph, Malabar tree nymph. Again, found in South India only. We have a tree nymph in Andamans also. We have a tree nymph in Sundarbans also. Sundarbans tree nymph is very difficult to see, but Andamans is very easy. Malabar tree nymph also, if you happen to be in South India, south of Maharashtra, in a good forest, you'll see a paper flying there or gliding in there. That is not paper, but the tree nymph. That's how you can see it very beautiful in the good forest. Now we come to Andaman Islands, another beautiful island with full of forest under the water. Also, you can go so much of wildlife, corals and butterfly fishes, and forests on the land also, the high trees. And there I went for a specific butterfly that is found only in Andaman Island, that is the Andaman swordtail. That is found nowhere else. It looks like a five-bar swordtail actually, but it is different. Maybe it possibly evolved for the five-bar swordtail once upon a time when the Andaman was close to the land. But out of isolation, this has evolved to another species. You know, isolation actually gives rise to species, different species. Out of isolation, even Himalayas also, different peaks have evolved into different species. Butterflies have been isolated from different peaks in Himalayas, and they have evolved into different subspecies. So in Andamans, now this species has evolved to a different species. Looks like fiber slightly, but it is not fiber. It is a Andaman swordtail. Another endemic butterfly is a club, Andaman club tail. Again, a club tail which has evolved because of isolation and has become an Andaman club tail. Again, endemic and rare species in Andamans. And this painted Jezebel is found in Southeast Asia and in Northeast India also, and Eastern Maharashtra, Eastern Ghats partly. So I found it in Andamans also. But basically butterflies, you know, now this is a breeding time and best time to see a lot of plants are growing now with the season to season, with the rains. You see a lot of butterflies mating and laying eggs and caterpillars around there. And butterflies usually mate with their own kind. There's rare cases of, you know, crosspoll, but, you know, of different species sometimes do get mated, but there's no progeny because, you know, DNA doesn't match. So that obviously stops them from producing hybrids. That's how the nature, you have a zebra or a horse breeding, but that progeny will not produce any new species. It stops there. Tiger and lion. They can breed. They can produce ligon, but ligon will not further breed because sterile breeds. That's how the nature has got its foolproof methods. So butterflies also mate with their own kind, and some butterflies lay in batches, like the tawny coster. You can see in batches they are laying eggs, and some butterflies lay one egg at a time, and not to invest too much in one bank, but you know, keep on different investments. So that's what they do. And female is the one who touches the leaf and confirms, you know, she tastes with her forefeet, and that's how she tastes, and then she confirms, and then she lays the eggs. And when after 3 days, the caterpillar develops within, and this is a egg of a crimson rose, another beautiful butterflies. And after 3 days, the caterpillar eats out the eggshell when it's fully developed and comes out, and first meal is the eggshell itself. It eats the eggshell and then starts eating the leaf on where it was born. And that's the host plant. Sometimes butterflies don't lay eggs on the host plant, but caterpillars are born, they will start searching for the host plant, they find it, and they will start eating. Usually it is nearby the host plant sometimes, but not on the host plant, sometimes. And that's the caterpillar of a fully grown caterpillar of a crimson rose, when it's fat and ready to pupate. You know, they are gluttons when they are caterpillars. They keep on eating, and they grow fast, and they shed their skins almost 4 to 5 times. That's the instars, you know, different instars, because when they grow, the skin doesn't grow. So the skin has to be shed, and that's how they molt. And they sometimes eat the skin also. And when it's fully grown, then it will look for a place to pupate, and that's where it will look out for a quiet place, a sheltered place where it will weave a silken thread. You can see the black silk which it has anchored itself, the hind end has been anchored, and there is a silken thread on its mid body also, which is anchored, and it remains like this. And now you'll see the change happening, and it's very fast. In the middle of the night, this pupa will start wriggling, and now it doesn't require the biting mouth parts and the so many legs also. So in the middle of the night, what happens? Look at that. The skin starts coming off, and the pupa is already ready inside. And you can see the pupa inside, they're waiting. And the skin, wriggles out, and the skin of the caterpillar is totally shed. And here the pupa is ready. And then it dries out within a few minutes. And then it stays there at one place put. For next 12 to 15 days, or sometimes in some 8 days, there's a magic happening within this pupa. All those old organs of the caterpillars are dissolved, and new organs are formed of a flying beautiful butterfly. It's a magic of nature. It's a rebirth, second birth of the butterfly. And that's the magic we'll see now. And let's see what comes out of this pupa. And you have to wait. It can happen anytime. Usually in the mornings it happens. So you have to see that happening. Let's see what happens. Look at that. Somebody's peeping out. Slowly the flap opens. Usually happens in the early mornings. And I have to wait right in the morning, from 4 o'clock, I waited, and that finally, yeah. This butterfly emerged at 7 in the morning. And look at that. Butterfly is now pupping out. And look at the red body and how it is coming out. You know, it slowly pushes the flap of this pupil case. And it pushes and slowly, slowly it comes out. If you see the, but you know, all the wings are crumpled and packed in one pupil case, and the belly is fat, full of the insect blood. Insect blood is a pale yellow, or not unlike our human blood. It has got copper. And slowly now it hangs like this, and it starts pumping the abdomen and body, and pumps the insect blood in the wing veins, and has slowly the wings open. And this happens in the early mornings, and within few, maybe 10 to 15 minutes, it's almost ready to, it's almost, but it takes time, or what, maybe it hangs like this for nearly 20 to 25 minutes before it takes off. And you can see that the crumpled wings are slowly into beautiful wings, are finally out and is open. And the even the proboscis is actually like a pair of two half tubes, half tubes, and they join together like a zipper. And now if you look at the wings, they're fully almost ready, but they're still limp. They're not strong enough. The butterfly can't fly yet and take their first flight. So when if you're rearing a butterfly, you should always remember that you should always give a big room for the butterfly to emerge. Because, you know, if you keep them in small bottles or something, and when they emerge, they don't have enough room, these crumpled wings will never expand, and butterfly will be handicapped for life and never fly. So if you're rearing, please rear them in large boxes, large, never in a small bottles. And here the butterfly is ready to take off. And that's a beautiful crimson rose ready. And look at the bright abdomen that tells the birds to keep off. So usually happens in the early mornings when the butterfly takes off and starts his first flight. But you know, during the pupal stage, surviving during pupal stage is very, very difficult because it can't fly. That's the only time it can, like a caterpillar will suddenly drop. If it is attacked, it will drop from the plant and go fall on the ground. And later on, it will quietly crawl out. Or a butterfly can fly, but the pupa can't fly. So here is you can see there are two twigs. One is the real twig and one is the pupa. That looks, the mimicry is so perfect, like a broken twig, that it is totally, you know, you can't make a difference what is the real twig and what is the pupa. And that is how it can remain invisible till it emerges with wings to fly off. That's an adaptation. And some actually are so confident with the toxins in their body that they advertise that here I am, take me. But nobody will dare to touch it because it is full of distasteful essences of the poisonous plants which the caterpillar had eaten. So, and they're shining and they're advertising their distastefulness that birds will keep off, like the common crow. This is a common crow pupa. And some, like the red pierrot, will burrow in the fleshy leaves, inside the leaf, and will remain hidden. Right? You can't see them from the top also, from the bottom also. And they are hidden. You see the caterpillar here in the edge end, and there's a trail of black droppings. These are black droppings in the leaf. That's a calentia or the bryophyllum. And it's, if you have this plant in your garden, it will come even on the 7th or 8th floor, it will fly and it will lay eggs. One of my students, Jennifer, she is living on the 8th floor, 7th floor, and that has come to her 8th floor and laid eggs. And here you can see, can you see? That's the pupa caterpillar of the common barren sitting in the middle of a mango leaf. See the pattern, even the yellow line that is aligned with the midrib of a leaf, and the fishbone-like structure on the caterpillar makes the caterpillar invisible. Invisible because no shadows. The ground-hugging structure means no shadows. Even the army structures are like that. They're ground-hugging. No shadows mean you can't see from the top. That's how the principle works. That's the common barren butterfly. Very common. You can see them in the mango if you're able to detect this caterpillar. So that's how the camouflage works, because survival is very, very difficult for butterfly, caterpillars and moth caterpillars, because they are the major food item for the birds, insectivorous birds. Especially when they are nesting, the butterflies will pick up, the birds will pick up a lot of caterpillars for the high protein diet for the young ones. So birds eat most of the caterpillars in your garden if you have a lot of nesting birds around your farms or your garden. And look at this, another classic example of mimicry. This is the orange oak leaf, but you have the blue oak leaf in South India. You know, this is the evolution of the nature sculpts. You know, possibly once upon a time, the oak leaf did have this kind of appearance. But maybe some of them started looking like, you know, slightly more brown, slightly more like leaf-like. Those individuals only survived. And they kept on breeding. And those successful individual bred. And this pattern slowly, slowly got refined. And it took possibly thousands of years to get into refinement because it doesn't happen overnight. But those genes were, you know, were confirmed and they were possibly were the successful genes. So that's what we call the survival of the fittest, because only those butterflies which looked like a dry leaf survived. Those who did not look like a dry leaf were eaten away. So that every generation got refined with a proper design. And finally, we have this design of oak leaf. So oak leaf, whenever it sits, it always sits ulta. So it looks like a leaf is connected with the tree. And suddenly, if you try to go near it, fly off. So when a bird attracts this butterfly, it flies off. You know, flies off with blue. And then again, it goes and sits on the dry leaf or a dry twig and becomes a leaf. And birds are still looking for a blue butterfly. It was looking, it was chasing. And you can't see. It is right sitting right in front of it, but it has become a leaf, a dry leaf. And that's how a simple trick of disappearing. A magic that it takes with, and this is called the adaptive coloration. And here you have the long banded or the silver line. They have a false head and a false antenna. That's called a decoy here. A decoy of having a false head and a false antenna. Look at the end here on the right side is the end of the tail with a very bright color orange spot. And there are antenna also where the birds, you know, usually are programmed to attack the eye region or the head region. So they usually end up with pecking up the tail end and the butterfly survives. You know, sar salamat to pagadi pachas. That's how the work it's in this defense. And then we have certain species like the bush browns and evening browns. They have the eye-like patterns. So if there is an attack, the attack will be on the lesser, less vulnerable part of the body, not on the head, not on the body, but on the wing edges. And butterfly, you can see many of the tatter butterflies flying there. They can still survive for a couple of months. That is the short lifetime they have. That's how this trick works. And usually in the wet season, this kind of formation you see. In the dry season, the pattern disappears and they become mottled like dry leaves and they disappear among the leaves. But that's not their breeding time also. They remain invisible. And this eye pattern is also important for the other, their own species to recognize their own kind. But of course, life of butterflies is not easy. You know, it's every corner there's a lizard waiting or a frog waiting, a tree frog, a toad or another specialized wasp which will attack the caterpillars. So there is always a robber fly trying to attack a butterfly. So there's always a danger waiting for a butterfly and it's not easy. But yes, still they survive and still they fly happily around as much. So the more to learn from butterflies. Because there are special parasitic wasps, like the one you see here on the left, you have the parasitic wasp, which has got it has laid eggs inside a commander's caterpillar's body. And now they have all the baby wasps have come out from the body and formed a white pupae. Those are the white pupae of the wasp. Because the mother wasp came and injected her eggs inside the commander caterpillar's body. And the caterpillar was not killed instantly. It was kept alive till all the babies grew and came out from the commander's body and it pupated there. Just like the alien you see in the movie. Here also the Nawab caterpillar is totally gone, dead, doomed. Because you see the pupa here, all these pupae of the white cottony stuff is the pupae of the parasitic wasp here. But the sporotin butterflies are evolved to ward off this attack. When a wasp comes to attack the caterpillar to inject eggs or lay eggs, there are parasitic flies also, tachinid flies and parasitic wasps. So whenever a wasp comes near, it you know, the special organ called osmeterium comes out and it gives out a pungent smell. It's an insecticide designed by an insect. Imagine. If that's the insecticide, it's to repel wasp attack. And that's the first insect I would say to repel insects. And that's the organ that only swallowtail caterpillars have. That's why Apollos also have that organ and other swallowtail caterpillars also have. That's why these all butterflies are called swallowtail because of this organ. Only swallowtail caterpillars have this special organ called osmeterium. That's basically to repel wasp attack. You know, basically in other countries now, they are specially breeding this kind of parasitic wasp. So instead of spraying pesticides, they are releasing this especially parasitic wasps, which are very host specific. They will attack only certain species of moth only, specific species only. Not like when you spray pesticides, they kill everything. The beneficial insects also and the pest species also. And that pesticide remains in the crop. And when we eat that food, fruits or crops, that pesticide comes in our body. You know, everything that is thrown, it comes on body. Today, I don't eat palak in Mumbai. Why? Because palak in Mumbai, it was tested that it has got 87% of lead, mercury and cadmium. This comes from where? The factories which are actually around Mumbai, they are throwing all their waste, industrial waste without treating. And that waste goes into gutter. And that gutter water is used for farming, spinach, palak and chawli. So I don't eat palak and chawli. I usually eat methi and shepu that come from Pune and drier regions, where possibly safer than eating palak in Mumbai. So whatever, and the fish now is smelling of kerosene. So whatever you are thrown in gutters and you are thrown in the sea has come back on our dinner table. So you can't get away from that. And in other countries, people have stopped spraying pesticides. They're going to organic, growing organic food and vegetables. Because pesticides don't kill insects. As I told you, actually butterflies can digest poison. They're actually using poison to protect themselves. So pesticide, any poison is nothing new to insects. They can possibly, one generation can die. The second generation becomes very immune, super insects. And then the company gets you another strong super pesticide. And you keep on buying pesticide. And the final victory is only the companies who make these pesticides. The pests, till today, not a single pest species has gone extinct. And all the pesticide that's pumped is gone into our bodies because we are the super predators. We're eating everything. Veg, non-veg, everything we've thrown, we're eating. So all the pesticides have gone into our bodies. So here is another predator that also waits for butterflies to come in, and like spiders. They are also very active, praying mantis, active hunters for predators of butterflies. And birds, look at the bills. These are basically insectivorous birds, like the black cap monarch, or you have the tickles fly catcher here. They are all insectivorous birds. You can say 85% of birds are insectivorous. They eat other than dal, chawal and grains. So they are very important for having around them in the farmland and where we are growing crops, because they control the pest species. They're very important. And that will reduce us to use of pesticides, which are more harmful than the pests themselves. But the major problem is the loss of habitats. You know, we have been losing habitats. Forests have been diverted for other purpose. There are so much of forests diverted for industrial. Of course, we require development. But then we have to use sustainably. You have to see where the impact can be lessened, as less as possible. And we can protect the forest as well, because this is our wealth. This is a biodiversity that has made kept India rich. You know, India has been victim so much of invaders, attackers along the history. But India has always remained rich, and today we are still growing and prosperous. Why? Because the land is rich, and because we have this kind of biodiversity, we have systems of good forest, good rivers, good water, and we have to have good air to keep our population healthy. And that is why we need forest. Forest is not for birds and butterflies, for our future. Because finally, we are part of this web of life. If we have to really give a good future for our next generation, we have to protect this. And we have to protect the life on Earth, because we are the first people. We are the life forms which are more intelligent than other life forms. And we know what is wrong and what is right. And we have the only planet we have, that is Earth. We can't go to Mars. Thank you very much, friends. Thank you for sharing time with me. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this wonderful session. Can we take some 2-3 questions?
Yeah, sure.
There is one question in the chat box. What is your opinion on the artificial butterfly park established in Singapore on the airport? Is it a good idea to confine butterfly ecology in the limited area?
I've seen also a lot of butterfly parks and butterfly, you know, there actually what they do, they enclose these butterflies in a wired or glass, actually, because many places, Europe and America, they don't have the weather like what we have. Like we have butterfly gardens here in India also. Of course, only Bannerghatta is one which is covered with glass. But, you know, butterfly population it helps in a sense of, you know, spreading the message. So I would say ki this is not going to affect the butterfly population. You know, butterfly population can be harvested. You'll be surprised. Like places when in Africa, where farmers were actually getting harassed by the animals. There was a jungle there around the farmland. And the elephants and baboons used to come there and attack the crops and rob the crops. So for the African farmers wanted to kill, cut down the forest and kill the animals. But then they started butterfly farming there. And butterfly farmings, the pupae were exported to Europe and American butterfly parks. And that fetched them dollars. And today those farmers are rich and they love butterflies. They love forest because forest gives butterflies and butterflies give them money. So population can be harvested and it doesn't affect the butterflies as such because so far the habitats are intact. It's not going to affect the population. And butterflies can be harvested actually for such purpose. And they are possibly a sort of coal at a small price to pay just to make people fall in love with nature. But of course, in India, you can't have enclosed park technically. In India, you can't have, like you have Olekarwadi in Thane, that's just a garden. So technically you can't, because butterfly is protected under Wildlife Protection Act. So like lions and tigers, you can't keep them as a pet or your private zoo. So similarly, butterflies also can't be kept under captivity. But yes, you can have an open-air butterfly garden. And that's the best way to have butterfly gardens in India. Closing, but in Banargatta, they have enclosed it. You know, the 6 crores they have spent and they have enclosed. But you know, keeping that is not like chicken. You leave 10 chicken and then chicken lays eggs and they become 20 chicken and 30 chicken dozen. The 10 butterflies they release, they die within 2 weeks. And again, they have to keep on releasing. So they are having big problem of keeping that entire Banargatta butterfly park populated with butterflies. So if they had kept open air with good flowering plants, host plants, butterflies would have come naturally because we already have a natural population. So nothing wrong in having a small butterfly parks like Singapore because it spreads a message. You know, we want people to fall in love with nature. And butterfly is a good ambassador for love for nature. And once people fall in love with nature, they'll protect nature. That is very important. So this is a small price, of course, but that's okay. It doesn't affect the population. Yeah.
Thank you so much. There is one more question. Is there any law around breeding butterflies at home?
Actually, technically, as I said, butterflies are protected by Wildlife Act, technically. But see, if you keep a couple of caterpillars and breed them, so recently there was in Facebook, not to rear caterpillars and all, it's nothing like that. See, if you are collecting large numbers for commercial purpose or in a large numbers, then you can possibly, forest department can take cognizance and can you be in trouble. But keeping or relaying caterpillars just fall in one or two in your bottles or jars is okay, nothing wrong. Breeding. So breeding butterflies at home, technically you should not have a trouble. But if you're using commercially, then possibly you are in trouble. So don't do that. But you can always rear butterflies for hobby. It's fun. No issues. Nobody will object to that. So if somebody's scaring you, don't worry. It is no offense. Don't worry.
Great. Thank you so much for this wonderful session.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Isaac. And once again, on behalf of our Nature Walk Charitable Trust, I thank Isaac for sparing time.
Yes,
and
sure,
for
sure.
Conducting such a wonderful session on butterflies of India. We got a great insight of the world of butterflies. And also thanks for touching the pan-India parts.
Yep.
I would also recommend people to also see iNature Watch website. It's very interesting. Yes, lot of programs.
Yes.
So correct.
Yeah, no, we have a lot of programs. Like we have got, we are conducting a special online course on butterflies. And we already had 2 batches, good successful batches of butterfly online programs. And we have on wildlife gardening for wildlife, how to attract butterflies in your windowsill. Like today morning also, when I open my garden, my windows, you know, sunbirds come and they come and they sing for me when I have my morning chai. And then, you know, after then butterflies start coming when it's not raining. So, you know, that kind of you can have attract wildlife to your windowsills or your terrace or your that kind of online courses we have. So you can always visit our website, as we said. Yes, why not? Anuj said you can always visit our website of iNature Watch Foundation for more for your interest in nature and learning on nature. I'm there. Yeah, thank you. And I'm on there. Facebook also. You can always contact me. You want to ask questions, you can write to me or I'm on the Facebook. Please contact me. I'll be always there for you.
Thank you so much. And on this note, we will conclude the session.
Yes.
So thank you, Isaac, once again for sparing time and having this wonderful session with us.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Thanks to all the participants. We have also put our Instagram and Facebook handles. Also, please log in to www.naturewalktrust.org, which will have all the details. And if possible, please paste your email IDs on this chat in this chat box. So I will also put the iNatureWatch website.
Yeah, please do that.
Email it to you.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you
for. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.